Good evening, everyone. I'm Elizabeth Wood, director of DocHouse, and as you just saw, we are going to be showing Jon's film Deja Vu tomorrow and Saturday, a remarkable film. But for this evening, we have the man himself, and we're very proud to have Jon Bang Carlsen with us this evening in conversation with Marc Isaacs. The evening is presented in a partnership with the Royal Holloway, University of London, and the masterclass will last for about 90 minutes. There'll be the opportunity for you all to ask questions, and so please turn off your mobile phones and welcome Jon Bang Carlsen and Marc Isaacs. You're in for a treat.
So, thanks everybody for coming. I've been wanting to do this for a while because I discovered Jon's films completely by accident, and not entirely by accident. I picked up a box set of his films at the Danish Film Institute, came home and watched them, and felt like I'd discovered a very unique voice, really. And also realised that your films weren't really known over here, hardly at all. And that was sort of a bit disappointing. So it's great that you're here. We're going to show, you know, the usual sort of format, showing clips, and I'll take a bit of a back seat just to make sure we keep the time and prompt you, keep you on track. And you should also feel free to chip in with any questions as we go along, because I think sometimes, you know, you forget at the end if there's things you want to ask in relation to certain clips. But the first clip is from 1981, actually, but you know, you have a history before that, and I thought maybe you could just introduce a little bit about your context. You know, I know you went to the Danish Film School, also worked in theatre for a while, and maybe just give us a sense of what happened before the first clip, which is a film called Hotel of the Stars. So just, you know, a little bit of preamble for that.
Yeah, hi, my name is Jon Bang Carlsen. I'm a Danish guy from Copenhagen. I'm 66 years of age and came out of the film school when I was in 1976 at Danish Film School. Actually, I tried to get into the Euro Film School here, the National Film School, but the day they actually accepted me, I had a phone call from my wife saying she was pregnant and she hated the idea about moving to England, so I had to go. So that's why you don't know anything about me. I mean,
it could have been also different.
That's because my former wife. But you know, I think that to cut it short, my problem was that I don't know how it is going to film schools these days. But when I went to film school, you had this kind of very, for me, very simplistic teaching about that documentaries have something to do with truth and fiction has something to do with inventing life or all that stuff, right? And that somehow it was possible to for the documentary camera to be this famous, stupid, for me, stupid fly on the wall, which was somehow unobserved by the characters it was filming. So when I came out of film school and I wanted to do my first story, I come from an upper middle class background, you know, north of Copenhagen, like from what is just Hampstead kind of place in north of Copenhagen. And from a family with no religious tradition, you know, with kind of very modern people in the 60s, and modern people in the 60s, they had few gods. Except you know, kind of what they could actually touch with their hands. So I had this, always had this kind of, I was always amazed about people who could believe. That has always fascinated me, and probably I had a need in myself trying to find somehow relating to something beyond the horizon of my stupid little brain, right? So my first story was a little story about a woman I met from a rural part of, very rural part of Denmark, an old woman who lived on a farm and had lived a very, very quiet life. But she had a relationship to a god, which I was impressed about, because she was very open to whatever happened in life. I felt she had some kind of strength. I went up to that little farm where she was together with the farmer's driving the farm. He was a bachelor, and there was this old woman. And it was a very quiet, everyday rituals, and of course there was like, just to say that, like, he's always out there dealing with the cows, she's in there, you know, waiting for him, for example, to come 11:30 for the coffee, right? And of course she's a little like pre-noon lonely, and she wants him to come back and that she has this little cup of coffee because he before he returns to those ever-absorbing cows again, right? And, you know, I when I did my research, I was there like 2 months, you know, I saw this one little moment, very fragile moment. It was lovely, was that every day, you know, she kind of put the table, 2 cups, beautifully laid out, cakes, the whole thing, as you know it from here, I could probably do the same thing here. And she was like looking out, she could look over the courtyard, she could see him still working with those fucking cows, right? And she was jealous with the cows because she wanted the man to be with her. Right? And, you know, he didn't come at 11:30 as he was supposed to do, and she tried not to, and she wanted coffee, right? So she tried not to break the rules because she loved those rituals, right? But finally, you know, she couldn't wait any longer, and she kind of opened the coffee thing and poured herself some coffee and put in 2 pieces of sugar. And then her little fat hand, you know, kind of stirred the cup, and you could see the muscle, the irritation in the muscles in her hand, right? Because he again forced her to do something. Life wasn't perfect, right? But when I came back to Copenhagen after having researched that story, you know, I found out that all the moments I wanted to portray in the movie was very small, fragile moments. And at that time, you know, back in 76, you had big film crews, even when you did documentary films. I knew that when I came back, you know, with my big crew of like young, bullish Danish workers, you know, I would have changed her pre-noon solitude fundamentally. I would never be able to film this because suddenly she was at a pre-noon cocktail party, right? So I decided what I could do, you know, my duty as a filmmaker, the way I function was, in order to be show her respect and the story I could tell, seen through my eyes. Was that I actually began writing down each and every scene, suggestions for lines. I knew that I had heard that she was saying. And then I structured, so actually like a feature film, I do fiction as well. I actually wrote the whole thing, you know, as fiction, and then she more or less played herself. And in that way, I kind of solved the problem with the problem with this dusting on sheets that the camera actually transformed the reality it's trying to convey, right? And on the other hand, I achieved something which is because I think if I have one talent, it's my eye. I could control my eye 100%. I hate that. You know, it's the shaking documentary camera is not, for sports and stuff like that, it's wonderful. But that camera that is shaking in order to achieve authenticity, I don't like that camera. I like a camera that is very, very precise in its choices, you know, I think that you as a documentary filmmaker, it's a stupid word, documentary filmmaker. For me, documentary filmmaking is telling stories, making narratives with fragments of reality. But you as a filmmaker, you manipulate and you have to be very honest about the manipulation, right? And then also it's also very important that from the very beginning, I felt it was very important for me to make myself vulnerable as those guys in front of the camera are vulnerable. And my vulnerability shows itself in, as you've seen some of the first film, in that everything is chosen, you know. I show my hands. The filmmaker should show his hand or her hand, right? He shouldn't, I don't like this thing about documentary filmmaker that we pretend that we are not there, right? I think that's very strange. It's a very strange conversation where one of the guys are invisible, yeah.
Let's watch Hotel of the Stars, which is a film made in Northern Hollywood, yeah?
Hotel of the Stars was a film. I did another film in Hollywood in the beginning of my career. And then the guy who is the lead in that part, I used him as an actor in the other film. But then I found out that he lived in this fascinating hotel. And it's actually just north of Hollywood Boulevard.
Let's watch the clip and then we can discuss more. It's a quite a short clip. Some of them are longer, but this one's quite short. So this is from 1981, this film.
See her through my eyes, she wouldn't look Didi at all. La da 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 Didi, Didi 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 Diva. But if you could only see her through my eyes. Dee 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 da da.
Hi. Come on in. A nice dip in the pool cool you off. Mm. Come on in. It's not that bad. A nice dip in the pool cool you off. Come on in, Dave. Misery loves company.
Hello, I'm Dan Patterson, and I'm an actor and a performer, a writer, publicist, human being. I do extra work occasionally here in Hollywood, and I've been in Hollywood since February of 1977, when I came here from Chicago to get away from the cold weather. Chicago was having its coldest weather in a century, so I just came out here to get away from it. And the first week I was here, I was walking my little dog down Las Palmas in Yucca, and I saw a television pilot being filmed. I said, hey, I wonder what's going on here. So I asked around, and I finally found myself talking to the producer and the director, a young fellow, 28 years old. And he said, well, would you and your dog like to be in? He said, I want you to walk from here to there and don't look at the camera. So I said, well, gee, that sounds easy enough. So that's what I did. I love to see myself in Technicolor. I've always loved going to movies. I like sitting there watching good actors and actresses practicing their craft. I long ago made up my mind that there's two kinds of people in this world. The ones who go to movies and watch others do it, and the ones that are up there doing it. I like to be up there doing it.
This Dan character, was he actually living in the hotel? He was...
I myself was, at that time, I got a job. I met Dan, and yeah, he was living in the hotel.
He was living.
But then he was doing Raging Bull down at something called Culver City Studios, where I did my absolute favorite movie, Gone with the Wind. So when he said that he could get me a job as an extra down there as a policeman, I needed German-looking policeman. And I was very German-looking, and he actually got me a full security number, and I started, you know, going around the. You know, where Robert De Niro was boxing, I was always going around, you know, like a policeman. And then, of course, you know, it suddenly dawned on me that, you know, for all those extras, Robert De Niro wasn't the main character. They were the main characters, you know, and, you know, they're very short time filming. Most of the time, we extras, we were talking, doing philosophy and all that stuff. So I've chosen, Dan, he was living in that hotel that you see here, right?
The microphone a bit close.
Yeah, he was living in that hotel. And then I decided that I wanted the hotel to be the main character. This kind of a symbol of, it had a very, very slow elevator, and a symbol of the beauty of the dream, but also the how far away the realization of those dreams were, right? So I started moving some characters into that hotel.
Okay.
The one I found on the set.
Okay. And, for example, the scene by the swimming pool, I mean, how did you go about choreographing that, because okay, they want to be actors, but they're not actors.
No, but of course now this thing is. I think it shows very obviously that they're not actors, right?
Yeah.
But I like the clumsiness of the acting, because for me it's like they interpret their own. It's an interpretation of themselves.
Because it's very self-conscious in a way.
They're very self-conscious, right? And for example, you know, by far the best Hamlet. I come from a rural little village in Denmark, and once, you know, that like the local teacher, he became very ambitious and wanted to stage Hamlet as a yearly show, right? And the butcher was playing Hamlet, and he was a very big, clumsy, mania, depressive guy. But for me, seeing him kind of being very rude about Shakespeare's wonderful text, you know, but the mixture of him and my knowledge, his Shakespeare's text, and my knowledge about the butcher, kind of gave me the strongest performance of Shakespeare's text I ever heard. I never met an actor who did it better. You know, it's somehow this hybrid of reality and the text was so strong. And I think to a certain degree, you know, the style, this kind of stage documentarism, as I call it, when it functions the best, it has this thing that that they somehow interpret, you know, something about them as characters, but then they interpret themselves, which I think give a kind of a richness in the dessert, which I like, right?
Yeah, they're almost smiling at their own performance in a way, which is quite interesting. No, but what about the dialogue? I mean, that line by the swimming pool.
No, but yeah, I do. You know, before I now this was, you know, working with Americans is always very different from working with, for example, Danes, because, and especially Americans in Hollywood, because they felt, you know, they fall in love with the camera. They love the camera, and they don't want to disappoint the camera. So your main task as a director is actually trying to suppress them because they want to change all of their own reality in order to entertain the camera, right? So if you want them to somehow look what they usually look like, you have to actually work very hard on kind of trying to get them back into what you perceive as being their identity, right? Yeah. But then I got, you know, a film like that, we did it, actually we did it only me and my cinematographer, and we lived at the hotel ourselves, and we, you know, we didn't have any permit to shoot there, so we had a kind of made an agreement with all the maids in the hotel, you know, that whenever the proprietor or the owner of the guy of the hotel arrived, we could take all our suspension balls out of and take away the lighting and take away the cameras.
Did you have a script for this film or not?
I had a script, yeah. But you know, Dan Patterson, he's impossible to control.
Yeah.
This guy is bursting with lines, right?
Yeah. And why did you decide to film, you know, like the second part is a more conventional sort of interview conversation moment?
Well, you know, because I think, you know, to a certain degree, you know, of course, it's very nice to have rules, but it's even nicer to break those rules sometimes, right? And I, you know, I love the way he looks into the camera, right? It's actually like he's looking at his lover, right? So I think that functions, right?
In the next film, it's interesting because it's almost the antithesis in terms of the characters and the environment, in that it's a small guest house. Actually, where is it in Denmark? Yeah, is it one of the islands, or is it?
It's actually, it's in the west of. Actually, in the old days, you know, there was a. If you went from Denmark to England, you took a ship from something called Esbjerg, and to Harwich, right? Harwich or something like that.
Harwich,
near Colchester, yeah. And there's a little island there on the west coast of Denmark.
It's a little guest house run by an old lady, and there's a maid there. And I mean, in terms of characters and performance, it's the complete antithesis, because they would, you know, they're totally not used to performing in front of the camera. But it's a very interesting similarities. I think we should watch that.
Yeah, let's see that, and then we can talk.
But do you want to talk a little bit about, just briefly, about how you arrived at that place, discovered that place?
Yeah, I discovered it because I do fiction as well, so I was doing a little children's story, you know, fictional story there. And then while I was, what I really like about filmmaking is actually putting up the camera, you know. So I always do the storylining myself. I draw all the shots before I start shooting, also when I do fiction. So I was in a very little hotel. So, and there was this very old lady who lives in that hotel, and who, one thing I always love about guys meeting people is that she was obviously still living in the 30s or 40s, and she couldn't. And she was totally conscious about that, and she was totally disregardful of contemporary times. This thing about being modern, she couldn't care less, right? She lived in her own life, and she was proud of that, and she would defend her own time. So she had chosen the 30s as being her period. And then there was very big windows, and I was going around in the dining room making shots. Then I saw her taking her bit. She was a very small, like bird-like woman, and she had this big, muscular, like a German shepherd. Right? And I saw she was taking out for a trip. And then she had it on a leash, and there were some sand dunes behind. And I saw her go out, and the moment they came out, this young dog, you know, exploded in joy, started running off. And you know, we're like 9 out of 100 other, or 1 out. Everybody, all the other women would have kind of let go of the leech. She just curled up and was dragged by the dog through the landscape, right? At that time, I was a rather young guy, strong guy, so I, you know, ran up to, out of the house, ran after them, caught the leech of the dog on one hand, and caught this very little woman under my other hand, and she was hanging underneath my hand here. And then she suddenly screamed, "Strangle it, strangle it." Then I knew this woman, I wanted to make a movie about this woman, right? Because she was like, and she's a little like that, she's like, go, she's a tough cookie, right?
Just a bit of context, so who did the Danish Film Institute fund the Hotel of the Stars?
That was funded by, in Denmark we had at that time, in the Danish Film Institute they had I don't know if you have any equivalent to that, that's something called a workshop kind of a funding scheme, you know, okay. Where young filmmakers, they could... just, you know, you just got money for the film stock.
Okay. Yeah. And the clip we're going to watch now before the guests arrive, that's 5 years later, was that funded by...
No, that was funded, actually, that was something, I did a 5 film for television, that is one of the films.
It's a television film?
Yeah, well, I shot it as a film, right?
Yeah.
Then it was financed by television.
Okay, great. Let's watch clip number two, please.
Golf Hotel Fanø. Ach, sind Sie da, Herr Bartetzky? Es freut mich, Sie wieder zu hören. Ja, Sie wollen hier rüberkommen. Ja, schön. Wann soll das sein? Vom 10. Juli bis 30. August. Und Ihre Frau kommt mit und die Kinder. Ja, schön. Und Sie wollen gerne Nummer 8 wieder haben, ne?
Jeg troede ikke, det var før i morgen, gæsterne kom.
Ja, det heller ikke. Det var mig, der snød dem og ringede på. Nu kommer bussen igen. Der er som sædvanligt ingen i, hverken ud eller hjem på denne årstid.
Nej, så er det godt, at der kommer nogen i morgen jo. Der kommer herr Fingerhut.
Ja, han er, det er for 20. år i træk, han kommer.
Ja. Så det bliver helt dejligt.
Jeg kan huske, da vi havde en prinsboende og en prinsesse med tjenerskab og det hele. Og der var det med omklædning til middagen. Men nu er det jo forandret sig. Nu er der jo ingen, der klæder om mere for at komme til middagen. Og han faldt i den første verdenskrig. For dengang gik officererne jo foran. Det gør de jo ikke mere.
Er det ikke snart tiden, at de skal giftes, fru Bæk?
Nej, det synes jeg ikke. For det har jeg prøvet en gang, og det er mere end nok.
Det kan jeg nu ikke rigtig forstå.
Ja, kan vi lige selv prøve at stille den op ud af
den? Nej, det ved de godt, jeg ikke vil. De må da ellers have haft mange tilbud nu, mens de har haft alle de gæster på alle de år.
Nej.
Har de aldrig været forelsket?
Nej.
Heller ikke i en gæst?
Nej. Heller ikke.
Det kan ikke have sin rigtighed. I må da have været forelsket på et eller andet tidspunkt.
Det tror jeg ikke. Så har det været, da jeg var barn. Og hold nu op med det brev.
Det er da ikke røv.
Jo.
It's so precise and worked out, but I mean, you know, when you're asking them to, I mean, like the phone call, for example, you know, do you have to shoot that a few times, or did she just do it? I mean, obviously, there's nobody on the other end of the phone, which is completely.
No, I think, you know, if you work in that style, you know, it's you have to do, of course, a very profound research. So you know, I'm really interested in those characters. I'm interested in the way they construct your sentences, the way they, all the movements, the way they wake up in the morning, all kind of details, much more than their intellectual ideas about who is right or who is wrong. I really love to study their choreography verbally as well as physically. And if I do my job well, if I write the scenes correctly, they fit her like a specially made for her sewn glove, or what do you call it, right? And she'll be able to do it like she is able to do the telephone.
So with that phone call, what directions did you give her?
Yeah, of course, you know, I wanted to build that little thing into the story, which was that I wanted her to tease the other woman, right? So I said, let's pretend that some guy calls in, you know, and say he wants number 8, right? And then
is this, you know, Mr. Potetsky, is he a real character?
No, just a made-up character. But he could have been. He could have been a real character. And then I said to him, like in that kind of conversations, there's always a little joke in the end, you know, and you laugh a little. It's always like that. And she did that beautifully, right? Much better than any actor would have been able to
much
do
better,
it.
Much, much better.
And then, you know, I know, then I, you know, in, before I do a little piece like this, it's only a very 16-minute long film, but everything is worked out beforehand, you know, like, also, when you, I don't know if you remember, the first you have, the only thing that wasn't worked out here, which was actually what you call a present. You know, usually when you do documentary films, you get a lot of presents from reality. So suddenly something happens that enrich your material, right? I never get those presents because everything is prearranged.
Are you open to those moments, though? Like, for example, if...
Yeah, but right here, there was one moment...
Well, you're not really geared up for them, I mean, with track and dolly and...
No, but I was... the very first scene you see, the scene where her putting up the big tableau or the painting of the ocean on that rusty nail on the wall, right? Which is, you know, something she does every year. I've been doing it for probably 50 years. And then, you know, when I saw it, you know, I decided, okay, here we have a... When I went back to Copenhagen, sat in my office and wrote down the storyline, I said, okay, here we have the very Freudian scene, old woman putting up ocean on rusty nail, right? And then she's putting it up there. Then you cut close to the reflection of her face in that thing. Suddenly you have a moment of peace. You see out of focus, you see a curtain in the background. You hear a dog barking off. Then you cut then suddenly you change focus to that curtain. You cut to the POV out the window. You see the dog coming towards you. Then you see those flowers coming down. All that everything is worked out. When I came to shoot...
Is that her real window?
That one is actually a real window, but when I came to shoot that scene, it turned out that I have forgotten that there was no glass in front of the fucking painting, right? So, sorry for my lousy language. But there was no glass in front of the painting, so I couldn't get my reflection, and I really wanted that reflection, that little moment of silence, just seeing her face superimposed onto that ocean, right? Yeah. Which you never see the ocean. The ocean is just next door, but you never see it in the film, right? So I really wanted that, so I told one of my guys to go and please go and get some glass on that thing, right? I didn't tell her. I forgot to tell her, I believe. So when we did the scene, you know, I said to her, okay, now, Mrs. Beck, her name, now you do like you do every year, you take this in a full shot, you take this thing, put it up on the wrist, rusty nail, right? And she takes it, and she, for some reason, she doesn't say anything about the glass. But when she lifts it up, it's double the weight it usually is. And of course, you know, for her, she tries to put it up because she's a very proud lady. Like she wants to kill that dog when it's on. You know, she wants to achieve what she wants to achieve, right? And she has been able to achieve that each and every year for fucking 50 years, right? And she doesn't want to admit that she's growing weaker with age, right? So suddenly, you know, she. And it's very hard for her, right? And the whole film crew, you know, film crew is always very, very, what do you call it, human, because they don't have to pay for it themselves, right? So all the old whisper into my ear, cut it off, right? But, you know, I just filmed on, right? Because I know, for one thing, I know my character, I know that she would actually succeed in the end, right? But if I had kind of said, okay, cut, let's do something else. She would have felt it was a defeat, right?
Yeah.
And I got a very beautiful scene. I think her little fighting, to get us, but that was you know, a gift from God, right?
But the other window was not a gift at all.
No, usually in this hotel, you know, I cheat a lot, you know, because if I don't like what I see out the windows, I make false windows and take it to somewhere like the bus, right? I didn't, it was actually in the middle of a little irritating town, so I made it some windows and I took it to somewhere and shot. Where there was a landscape out there, because
you even bother to be in an interior and put the window up, or you just put the window up in the landscape.
Yeah, yeah.
So that you're not even inside a house.
No, we're not. No.
But that's documentary.
No, but you know, because I try to defend myself is. But you know, I have this line. You know, now I have worked it out, so I want to tell it. That if you want to say that documentary filmmaking has anything to do with truth, right? Then you have to really find. Truth without excluding lying, right? It's because I think for me lying is very, you know, you can say poetic license is an enormous important part, you know, because nobody knows her reality, but it's my duty as a film director to tell the story. You would have told another story, right? The story I can see through my eyes. I have no idea how you would see the story because I'm imprisoned behind my own eyes. I can only hope that if I'm very, very truthful to my own emotions, and don't use my brain too much, you know, use my emotions, right, in the way I pick moments, then maybe somebody else in the world can use it for something in their research in how to look at this world, because that's another, like, line I love is this thing that you have to invent your own reality, right? It's each of us have to invent our own reality. We cannot use other people's reality. To a certain degree, we all have to invent our own reality. That's part of our task. While this little time we are here on Earth, right? And I can only hope that, you know, this is my reality. It's a kind of reality, a mixture of me and Fulbeck has made this kind of reality. Hopefully somebody can use it for something. And therefore, you know, those little coincidences, like what's actually outside her windows, I don't want to be victimized by them, right?
Yeah, a slave to that. Yeah. It leads on nicely to the... Yeah, go and ask questions.
Sorry, I just wanted to go back to...
Break the ice of...
Yes. Sorry, when you're talking about...
Do we have a microphone, or do we need a microphone for the recording?
I can talk louder if that's...
Okay. They're recording everything.
So, talking about the...
Sorry, going back to the, when you were talking about that process of profound research, how long does that process take before you feel fully confident that your choreography is going to be able to accurately reflect their reality?
No, of course, that depends very much on the subject matter. But with these two ladies, you know, I did a fiction film there before, and she was actually an extra in that fiction film, so I knew her in and out, right? And of course, I'm also depend very much because when you are in a non-intellectual environment, it's not films that ask you, how are you? Tells, you know, I don't care about what she means about you or death penalty or what, something like that, right? It's a totally emotional landscape we are. Of course, I'm very independent that there are some kind of relationship in between me and her, right? That we kind of, I think, I used to say there has to be a keyhole between me and my characters in order for them to feel, to believe in you, trust me, they have to trust me, right? That I'm not exploiting their vulnerability, you know, with my camera, right? Between me and her, you know, I think we had a sense of humor, right? We had the same sense of humor, right? And we, to a certain degree, I could have strangled that dog as well, right? who have same kind of brutality. What do you call it? We're not gentle people.
he's very gentle. It leads quite nicely onto the next clip. It's jumping 10 years ahead, but I wanted to show it because there's an accompanying film with it as well, which you can watch on. I can give you some details of a website afterwards. The film is called Now. It's Now or Never, but then there's an accompanying film that talks about the making of that film called How to Invent Reality, which you're actually writing a book about, this How to Invent Reality. But the story of this film is, it's set in Ireland. It's about old farmers, or one particular one, looking for a wife. And actually, it occurred to me that this is a story that probably somebody's done it, could be made as a very straight documentary, in the sense that it's a real story, that this situation that exists. But you impose your own reality on this, or invent your own reality around this. Do you want to just sort of say a little bit about, maybe just a bit of context with that, and then we can watch the clip?
Yeah, well, all the stories I do have something to do with myself, and then... And I sometimes after having been married like 20 years, I thought, why is it so important for me, and suddenly me and my partner was kind of grown together, became like one tree instead of two trees, you kind of grow together, right? And then I asked myself this question, why is it that we all want to share life with somebody? Why don't we just, have kids and then split up again and or something like that? Why is it so important to this togetherness, right? Some of us, right? At least I'm like that, right? And then I wanted to tell the story. Then I heard about, we always read something in newspaper. I heard about a place called, some place in County Clare in the west of Ireland, Liston Barna, it's called. Mm. They have a very beautiful, very century-old tradition about, those farmers in that area, Irish farmers, are always, one of the guys always left on the farm. Everybody goes to England, to Liverpool or something like that. And then in Liverpool, they have a tradition of all those lonesome working class women, where the husband, he disappears in some pub or whatever happens, go to London to do something. And then they take busloads of women from the Liverpool area and take it to Liston Varna once a year. And they have a whole ritual, beautiful ritual about like dancing and daytime, and they have a, if they're interested, you kind of squeeze two times or something. If you're not interested, you squeeze their hand three times or something. Bring people together, right? So I went to see that, and I was very fascinated. It was very beautiful, but I cannot make that movie. You might be able to do that movie because that's an uncontrollable reality. I cannot control it with my camera, right? I cannot break it up into small fragments. But then I just happened to drive around in that part of Ireland, and then there's just north of it, there's a place called County Clare, which is kind of limestone, and it's kind of a mixture of small limestone mountains, which are kind of the greys. I wanted to have an old bachelor, greyish hair, and then he should be this kind of bachelor with kind of still, some bachelors still have a very boyish aspect about them because they haven't been being made rude by living with women, right? They still have this kind of boyish tenderness to them, and I wanted to find one of those characters, right? And the landscape itself, it had this kind of gray limestone, which is like age, and then it had those patches of really green grass, which is kind of youth, right? So there was something about that was a good location for me. So I decided to try to find a bachelor there, and what we're seeing is one of those guys, one bachelor I found to play. It's a real guy who kind of plays himself here. Yeah.
Let's watch the clip and then we'll continue.
You must be Jimmy.
How do you do?
How are you, Keith?
Nice to meet you.
It's a mixed old day enough, isn't it? Yeah. The climate is nearly as temperamental as the women. Jimmy, you gave me a call the other day with a view to meeting a partner.
That's right.
And I have a number of women now, of females, like they're quite scarce enough in the West, but I have a few that I feel might be suitable enough for you,
Right.
What kind of a woman would you have in mind yourself? What would you be actually...
Well, I've been waiting a long time to meet a woman that can milk cows, look after general farm work. One that would be fairly economical. A woman that would know how to spend money.
Would you like a woman to be quietly tempered, or would you like maybe a passionate woman in bed? Or
she'd want to be on the kindish side, you know, fairly kind, and, well, she'd have to be reasonable.
Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't want her to be perfect in any way, but she'd have to be reasonable.
You were kind of saying, saying you like someone that,
could milk cows.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. She could hand milk cows for me.
Yeah, that.
You know, the good milker. I wouldn't mind her being a bit religious. She could go to mass whenever she wanted to, but she'd have to be able to milk cows for me and look after me.
No, there's a widow woman, that woman there now on the rise.
She able to milk cows?
I don't think she's able to milk this one, though. She's not into milking, but
no, for me, sir.
Now, there is a girl here, actually. She is a farmer's daughter, and she'd like to meet somebody with a farm. Now, the problem with her is that her father, her mother, and her brother and herself are going together. How would you feel about that with the four of them going?
I wouldn't mind if I was boss. I'd have to be boss. Then I'd marry her tomorrow if I was boss. But
yeah.
I wouldn't like to be married in someone else bossing me.
Physically, how would a woman love to look? Would she want to be small and or very tall and attractive, or small and stout, or what way would you like it?
Handy-sized woman, round the 10-stone mark,
yeah.
Reasonable in looks, nice personality.
What a girl I have found is another man's love.
I mean, we should talk a bit about comedy, because we haven't mentioned that so far, but that's of course in all of the films, and so many documentaries and inverted commas are very boring and not very funny, and they don't use the. Obviously when you're casting, you're thinking about that. I mean, but just more specifically in relation to this scene, did you hold back information like with one of the characters in terms of? Did you tell certain characters some things and held back from the others, so there will be surprises in the scene that. That would kind of come out.
So
they're kind of reacting, thinking on their feet a bit.
The matchmaker, he didn't know Jimmy.
You'd never met him before.
No, they never met before. So I knew about his kind of devotion to women milking cows.
Yeah.
He's a little confused about that aspect of the matchmaker. Right?
Yeah.
But otherwise, you know, it's a very conventional shot.
And also, so you sense that with the maid as well, that you hold back you hold back the prank from her as well. So she's
But that scene, the film you saw before with the two old women, the scene where they're talking about why don't you get married, you know, I only give lines to the other woman, the assistant, because I know how Mrs. Beck will react. And then I do in the way I choreograph the scene. You know, I see them in a full shot, and I know that as long as the two women can see each other, Mrs. Beck, the old woman will not show her fragility. She will not show how very interested she is in love, actually. So therefore, I ask her to go towards the camera, and then I pan with her, and she sits down on a chair with those flowers and look like a withered Ophelia, right? But then now that they have broken their eye line, right? And then at that very moment, you can actually see how her face, she is not a tough woman anymore. She actually shows her very interest, like she said, oh, I don't want to be married, but then she kind of leans forward behind the flowers. Let's talk more about it, right? She shows suddenly she becomes very vulnerable, right? And very girlish. So you have to from a psychological point of view, make your camera work so it kind of enhances those elements.
Are you sometimes like Trey, you know, shouting out things from behind the camera?
Very much so, yeah. Very much so, yeah.
You have to watch the making of the film about the making of this film. You can. There's a website, vhx.com, isn't it? And Jon's films, some of his films are on there, they're very cheap. But then there's this film, How to Invent Reality, which, you know, we see a lot of the film being made and see you shouting behind the camera a bit. So there's a moment where you sense like the scene is dying and you might try and keep it going, or then you decide to cut and reframe on close-ups. And you get them to do it a few times, or...?
Of course, you know, sometimes we have, but mostly not because of them, mostly because of clumsy cameramen or something like that. that you fucked up the tracking shot or something, then I have to do it again. Yeah. But it's very bad, of course, to ask them to do stuff many times.
Well, I was curious about that because, you know, there's a lot of actors in that way. So.
But I have to say that, of course, one reason that this style actually functions with people is that I have never met anybody yet who didn't. We have a lot of fun with doing this stuff because suddenly, you know, we are playing around with life. Suddenly, you know, you can, instead of having this where you go and open a door, it's always the same thing out there. You know, it's so enormously boring. If you, after you have seen this show, you went out and opened the door to the, whatever the road street is called out there, and suddenly it was a valley in Wales or something like that, you would be entertained, right? It would be fantastic. Right? You will remember this evening, right? And for them, when they participate in this film, I kind of take their life and then I kind of throw it like some porcelain, I put a drop on the wall and it became small fragments, right? You have to put together again. And that's a relief for most of them because suddenly they are free of their destiny to, and they can play around with it. And also they get something which at least maybe you are allowed to look at yourself in the mirror in England, I don't know, but in where I come from, Northern Germany, you know, the Northern Germanic tribes, it's not good manners to look at yourself in the mirror. It's not good manners to study your own face, right? It's supposed to be self-obsessed or something like that. But actually, sometimes you have to look at yourself in the mirror. And this way of filmmaking, of course, give all the participants a possibility to study themselves. You know, how do I get out of a? How do I position myself in the bed in the morning? How do I get out of bed? How do I sit in when I'm alone in my dining room? What do I do with my body and with my head, with my hands? It's very interesting for them. It becomes a mutual. Checking stuff, life out, right?
I mean, apart from the USA and Ireland, you've also spent quite a lot of time in South Africa. I'm going to show a few clips from, I think you made more than half a dozen films there. We're going to show clips from some of those. The first one, maybe you should say a little bit about how you ended up in South Africa, but in the first clip we're going to see is from a film called Addicted to Solitude, which is in a way, more of a straight documentary. But do you want to talk a little bit about how you arrived in South Africa?
Yeah, it was just by a coincidence. I make features as well, and I was showing a feature I did in Joburg, and I don't like flying, so I took a rental car and drove down to Cape Town. And on the way there, there was suddenly a sign saying to Marienborg, and there was down a dirt road, and I saw that's a Danish name of a Danish farm. So I became suddenly sentimental and went down that dirt road, and I was like driving for, like typical South African thing is, I had no idea how big this country is. You're like driving for like 3/4 of an hour, and finally this farm arrived, and it looked exactly like the farm from Gone with the Wind after the war. You know, you had this kind of old classic romantic facade, but now besotted by black, you know, black smoke, like after the war in Gone with the Wind, and behind it you had those black boxes where the black workers lived. I knocked on the door, and this guy comes out, and he was actually a mirror reflection of myself. He was like a stocky guy, you know, with no kind of a jewelry or anything, just a piece of flesh, you know. And I thought, this is another Dane, right? A functional piece of tool, you know, who doesn't enjoy anything but working, right? With no sense of the finery of life, right? And I started talking Danish to him, and he looked at me as I was even dumber than I am. Because, he was an Afrikaner, and I had no idea there was an Afrikaner. Then I found out that this Afrikaner culture, which is actually pretty much like the culture I come from, this Northern European kind of farmer culture. And I saw it, and of course, for me as a guy who tells stories with fragments of reality, suddenly to have my own Danish reality put in between big, powerful black cultures, you know, was a very dramatic, was kind of a dramatic increase of my ability to as a storyteller. So I decided, I asked my wife whether she wanted to move down there. We moved down there, lived there for almost 10 years.
Let's watch a clip from Addicted to Solitude. This is from 1999, so 3 years after Now or Never.
People will have to start listening to each other. There'll have to be less drinking and violence in their homes and that type of thing. Then South Africa might become a nation again.
It's hard to trace a story in Africa. The landscape is too big, and there are too much beautiful silence to share with strangers.
God is going to be a, you know, he takes us one by one, eh? I just don't know if... They say he's going to come on the clouds and that type of thing. You never know when he's going to come, but I'm sure he is going to come. He'll have to come. He'll have to come and save somebody. even if it's just a few. But God is very, very near. Oh, he's extremely near. I think he's just about a breath away from everybody. Do you believe in God? He means everything to me in my daily life. He's a means to the end, because you know, you feel you're just an alien, you're just passing through. Whatever you own, you don't really own, nothing really belongs to you. If you buy property, it belongs to the government. If you send your child to school, he becomes a strange little being to you. When he leaves your home, he belongs to another woman or something like that, but there's just another way. You've just got to go through this earth to get to heaven. It's just a passage.
How do you see paradise?
I can't imagine paradise. I don't know what paradise is all about. I can't imagine doing nothing all day, singing and playing the harp or that type of thing, but I do. I think deep down I believe in reincarnation.
As time went by, I got the suspicion that her real world couldn't be photographed. There was something magic about her. Therefore, I wasn't amazed when her former husband entered the shop the very moment she mentioned the word reincarnation. He lived next door, so I decided to intrude on him with my questions as well. Looking for a story, you have to choose a little corner of reality and just hang on.
So, who are you?
Don Lederman.
And could you just tell me who you are, what you do, and what your profession is?
I'm Don Lederman. I'm a tax consultant, financial consultant, and going in for income tax, retired farm. Now I just go on with my hobby.
I was married to this man that comes in here.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I was married to him. And I had the children at home. I lost one child when he was 16. He was mentally retarded.
And it's a small Karoo town in the heart of the sheep world.
It's got a lot of history. It's got a lot of... There's a lot of culture and there's a lot of heartache here.
Small town with little business.
Got lots and lots of character, and there's a lot of characters around it too.
Population has been down a lot.
Some are religious and some are not. Some are rich and some are poor.
Were you born rich?
No.
That's why I especially love the Karoo. In my area here, the openness, and you can even say the sort of a loneliness.
I mean, I love the reality of this film, but it also feels very... I mean, were you... This sequence, for example, I mean, I know it's not shot in the same time or day or whatever, but, I mean, was this, for you, research notes, or was this always going to be the film as it is now, or...?
No, actually, this film, I did that some years after I did this Irish movie, and now we don't see the main character. The main character in the movie is a very young woman who lived on a farm, on a big farm. Her husband went to Joburg, and they found his jeep full of blood, but they never found the body. So they couldn't declare the man dead, and therefore she couldn't sell the farm, and she couldn't pay her workers. She was going totally down, you know. And she was, of course, what they call down there, a very soft target. She was like in the middle of nowhere, all by herself. I wanted to do it my usual way. I worked with a thing, something called Film Africa in Cape Town, you know, so I always wanted to shoot it on 35 with a big crew.
Okay.
And, but then I lived, she lived literally in the middle of nowhere, you know, like 1 hour to any neighbor, except her workers who was living on the farm. And then I did my research as usual with my little camera, you know, doing all this stuff. And
so in a way, this was a kind of research.
Yeah. Then it dawned on me suddenly that I really loved that young woman you don't see here. You know, the way her story, the way she vibrated with my little camera, And it dawned on me that she was not the kind of character. She didn't have a performer in her. No. Like, of course, the Irish guy, he has a performer in her. Dan Patterson from the first film had some kind of little hidden performer. Mm. Even Fru Beck, the old lady, kind of, she couldn't care less. She was too proud to. She ignored the camera like some stupid thing, yeah. You know, who just happened to be there, right? of non-importance, right? But this woman, she was shy. She was a Dane. She, in that way, she was very Danish, you know. The big camera crew would have killed her.
Really. Yeah.
So I decided, you know, that actually, like what John Lennon said, you know, what was supposed to a life a film is what happens while you're doing other stuff, right? Planning. So the film happened. I shot the film without knowing it, right?
Yeah. But it gives it a really special feeling, kind of.
Yeah, it has a certain rawness to it. Yeah.
I mean, that line about, you know. It's a good line for students to hang on to. You know, when you're looking for a story, you have to find a corner of reality and just hang on. You know, I think temptation is always to run off to the next thing, and you know, and sometimes just to sit there.
Yeah, I stole that from a French poet.
Yeah, of course, it's stolen. Even that's not you. But I think it's really, you know, it's a beautiful film for that reason, that you're just with her. And also, the way you film it, you decide to. At the back of the shop for a long time, we don't really see her face clearly.
No, because but then,
but do you look back on it and hate the quality of the image, or do you?
No. Of course, now I suddenly hear it's a kind of strange squeaky sound. But
yeah, there's different sounds.
Yeah, there's a strange sound here, but I think it's whenever I start up doing a new movie, I always try to clean my slate 100% and say all the experience I've had, I cannot use them for this, because every movie. Needs a new language, right? You have to find a new vocabulary to grab what you want to grab now, right? And to cooperate with those characters in front of the camera. And here, you know, of course, one of the big, both with this old lady, but also with the young lady, a huge part of the movie is me hanging around with those women in the silence of their very, very silent days, exactly, right? Yeah. And totally, so kind of eliminating time. There's no coming, there's no going, they're just hanging in there. Until everything withers away, right? Yeah. That's where that's the quality of the movie, right?
With the narration, is that the first time you used any of your own narration in a film?
I did this just the right amount of violence with How to Invent Reality, which is kind of an essayistic film on It's Now or Never on my style, right? Yeah. And that is.
But did you is that narration, you know? Sort of conceived largely in the editing suite, or do you look back at notes? Do you take notes when you're making?
I always write a diary while I shoot, and very often I can use lines from my diary in the final film.
Another film in South Africa I want to show a clip from is called Purity Beats Everything, and the reason why I wanted to show it is there's two sort of distinct layers in the film. One is you filming the characters in a fairly similar way to this, and you know, in a straight, quite documentary way. And then there's a whole other stylized element of you and your farm in Denmark, which we should talk about after this.
Yeah, okay.
So this is number five. This is 10, almost 10 years later than Addicted to Solitude, isn't it? 2008?
Something like that,
Okay.
The Germans always chose high holidays and saintly days for the Jews to do the most terrible things. So we were hidden in an attic, about 30 people, and my father was wearing his talus, and he was praying to God for salvation. We were all standing there, and you could kind of look through, because there were cracks. And they were rounding up men, women, and children, and they were shooting them, and they were stacking them up like logs of wood. And they were lying higher and higher and higher. And I remember, here was Yom Kippur, and we were praying, and there outside, the Germans were killing innocent people. And I remember this enormous feeling of just, I don't know what I felt.
At the beginning, in the ghetto, we still tried to lead a little bit of a normal life. Because we were still hoping that this war will not last much longer, and we will live through it. My My mother was always an optimist. It didn't save her. We managed to get into Teben's slave factory. It was a matter of life and death. To get into such a slave labor factory in the ghetto, which was run by the SS. My parents worked the day shift. I was doing the night shift. I only used to see my parents when I was leaving the factory, and I saw my parents line up and go in. One morning, we were not let out of the factory, the night shift on which I was. The gates were barred, locked. We were not let out. So we understood that something was happening outside. When we were eventually let out, the streets were littered with belongings, with bodies. The whole line of 5,000 people was taken away. Now I was on my own. Our brains couldn't fathom it, that people can be gassed, their bodies burnt to ashes just because they were Jews. Menschen. That's what Hitler called the Jews. It was a race of Menschen.
Wollen wir ihn, wenn nötig, totaler und radikaler, als wir ihn uns heute überhaupt erst vorstellen können?
Now, they used to collect people on the Umschlagplatz. One had to wait there until the trucks came. The Umschlagplatz was another theater of horror.
Dante's Inferno is nothing compared to what happened there. We were there for 3 days, and my father and mother had a sock which they had filled with sugar. The two children, my sister and I, every couple of hours, they would give us a teaspoon of sugar, but they never touched that sugar. And all the 3 days that we were there and the journey that we went to the death camp, they kept on giving us a little bit of that sugar, but they never touched it.
I can hear the wheels clicking as the cattle train is taking us from Warsaw, from the Umschlagplatz.
Mine to hovedpersoner kender ikke hinanden, men der er en grusom parallelitet mellem deres skæbner, som vidner om de tyske bødlers sans for kold logisk kalkulation og ubønhørlig præcision i virkeliggørelsen af deres strategi, for at slippe af med alt fremmed blod.
Of course, my parents, who had lined up then to work, were taken away, and I never saw them again.
Var det derfor, der var så stille mellem bondegårdene, mens vi 50'er børn voksede op? Havde vores forældre en mistanke om, at den tankegang, der havde myrdet Miriam Listermanns familie, var en central del af vores egen tankegang? Lider vi den dag i dag af samme perverterede lyst til at være hinandens kopier, til at renliggøre langt ind i døden? Er det det, stilheden ikke til at sige?
I actually found it very hard to know where to stop this clip when I was trying to choose it. It's kind of, you get immersed into it, it sort of pulls you along. It's really interesting. And, but just say something about how the idea came to sort of, you know, have these sort of two worlds of South Africa and then you and your farmhouse in Denmark, and how you developed a way of filming your environment instead of, I mean, you use archive once, but instead of, you know, using, relying on archive generally.
Yeah, the when I was lived in Cape Town, I always went to this Jewish coffee shop, and there was very often I saw, you know, in South Africa, it's like the young Jewish guys, they go to here or to Australia or to America because of affirmative action, which of course I have had to introduce in order to give the black culture a chance to get into the good jobs, right? And therefore, suddenly there's a lot of old Jewish women left, and you very often see those very old Jewish ladies sitting around, you know, by their mates, black mates. Those mates, they very often come from townships that have serious problems with security. So you very often, what I was looking for was a story, once an old Jewish lady and a big youngish mate that I once heard that the Jewish lady, she was kind of hiding away in this apartment. All her kids had gone to America, I think, and the black maid, she was too insecure for her to be in the township. So they lived together up there in an apartment, and somehow this, you know, this kind of mutual destiny between the old Jewish maid who had been to concentration camp and this young maid, youngest maid who had experienced the whole thing with apartheid and that kind of reflection of what that purification, that Sikh purification, so that was what I wanted to do. Right? I never managed to find I did a lot of research. I never managed to find those two characters, but then I found Miriam Listermann, who, like everybody in South Africa, had a black mate, but she wasn't very close to the mate, right? But then when she started talking, you know, I suddenly realized that, you know, I don't know much about, the reason I wanted to do this story was that my generation, of course, it was very strange growing up in America, in Denmark in the 50s. And we never related, you know, my parents, the culture, the school, we never related to what happened like 5 years before I was born, right? We never talked about it. And then it dawns on you what this enormous, tragical, this kind of the blackness of blackness that is part of all of us, and it's not mentioned. So I knew that someday I would have to try to touch on it, seen from a Danish perspective, because we are, you know, we had the same mentality to a certain degree. We didn't have the kind of the German historical reason to take it to that dramatic length they took it, but we had the same mentality of purification, right? But then when I met Miriam Listermann, the reason I did the movie was that I found with her was that I thought she was amazing at telling her story. And I found out that actually I suddenly realized what art is when it's very good, because I turned to find out that she was actually, there's another scene where I asked her to tell the same story two times, because she had, in order for her, of course, telling that story, it becomes too, it's for her, it's now, right? When she tells the story, it happens right now. And it kills her. It's so hard to tell that story, right? And therefore, in order to survive telling that story, which she feel politically obliged to tell, to inform coming generations about not repeating that kind of stupidity or brutality, she had had to turn herself, she has to has actually had to turn it into a piece of art. She has turned her story into a piece, the way she phrases, the way she gestures, it's a performance, right? In order to survive telling it again and again. And I thought that was very beautiful, right? And I think she's actually a master in telling her story, right? How should I visualize that story? Then, of course, suddenly, after coming back to my farm, I live on that farm, coming back to Denmark, when I sat there listening to her story on my equipment, right? Then, of course, that's what I have experienced. You know, I sit there and I look out on that, which actually looks like something from country living, right? But at the same time, listening to her story, suddenly, you know, the stones out of my the yard in front of my house, you know, suddenly it becomes like Umschlagsplatz in Warsaw, right? And suddenly, you know, I kind of can, it become dramatized, right? So I could have all the visuals there, and I actually, it was very interesting to trying to suddenly, and I think that's where how we all do, you know, when we whatever, you know, we influence, you know, we transform our reality into staging that kind of the narrative that we are obsessed, we are getting introduced to, right?
Yeah, I'll never look at washing lines in the same way.
No. Yes?
I'm just fascinated by what you said at the beginning of the session about offering something of yourself, about offering something of yourself to your contributors.
And this is a particularly painful story that this lady's telling, and is offering it as a performance to kind of aid that, or ease that pain. In what way do you offer yourself as a kind of... Because it's fair, isn't it? If someone's offering you their story and their, however painful that is, it's fair that you also offer something of yourself. And I agree, I as a filmmaker, I approach the interview and that way, but how would you define how you do that?
That's what I said in the very beginning about making myself vulnerable, mm-hmm. so that I was mm-hmm. similar in my vulnerability yeah. to the people in front of me.
So do you tell them your painful stories and that kind of thing, or do you...
No. I just think in this film, of course, you know, I make myself, which actually, when it showed it premiered at a festival in Holland, and some young Jewish people actually got very, very aggressive with the movie, because they had this point of view, which I will not discuss whether it's right or wrong, that it was their story, and I was being who I am, mm-hmm. I shouldn't tell the story, right? I disagree with that, of course, otherwise I wouldn't have made the film. I think it's a story. We all have to relate to that story, right? But of course, in this, you know, what I meant by saying that is that, you know, in documentary filmmaking, which is a very primitive thought, but there is, you know, still is this thing that people are hiding behind, you know, they're pretending mm-hmm. they're not there, right? Mm-hmm. They're pretending what is happening in front of their camera lens is actually reality, whatever, you know, for me, it's totally bullshit, and it's actually very dangerous bullshit, right? You have to show... you know, as a storyteller, right, a documentary or fictional, you shouldn't kind of, you know, there was a tendency to a certain degree sometimes in fictional filmmaking that people started to shake the camera because then it looked a little like it was a documentary mm-hmm. story. And I think it's so enormously primitive also from a philosophical point of view, because, of course, you have to touch the subject matter. You have to manipulate it with a hand, a manus, right? You have to put your hand on the world and show how you put. You have to inform the spectators about who is telling this story. Otherwise, it becomes for me, I cannot use it for anything, right? I have to see, you know, I have to see the storyteller. I have to see his or her hand, the way she kind of arranges those fragments of whatever it is, emotions. In this case, of course, it's reality as well, right? In order for me to be able to use it in my life, right? So is that an answer
to
your question?
Yeah, that's my answer. Okay, super transparency and
we can when you're in this position, you always try to find links to the next thing, which is a bit is that what radio DJs do?
The what?
I had a link to the next clip.
Oh yeah, okay. Oh, you found one
here. It's okay, it's still there. I thought she was going to destroy it. Destroyed by you.
Okay.
Yeah, of course. I asked about déjà vu that we've seen previously. First of all, I have to say that I was very impressed. It's a very accomplished work, but I was wondering about the therapeutic aspect of it, because you start from a childhood trauma.
Can you put it a little closer to your mouth?
Oh, yeah. You start from a childhood trauma, and
I was wondering, maybe it's a personal question, but I was wondering if it came out of psychoanalysis or if it was a sort of a psychoanalytic process for you.
Deja vu starts with a childhood trauma, and he's asking whether it was a psychoanalytical process for you or came out of psychoanalysis or not. Can we hold back on it for a minute? Because the next film clip can maybe lead us into that as well. I'll stick to my link. Because it's about a film that, on one level, it's a film, more than one level, but it's a film about in America where these guys, what they call interventionists, go into people's...
Should I answer his
question? I think we can come back to it because it's neatly connected. And then we can just go into more discussions because we're a little bit pushed for time. It's a film about these guys that take American kids from their beds in the middle of the night with the approval of their parents and send them to correctional schools. That's one layer in the film, a bit like South Africa, which is fictionalized. Some of the people are real playing themselves. But another layer is John includes his own personal story in that film as well. So let's just watch that and then we can come back because it relates to your question specifically as well. And then we can move on to the some general questions. So if you've got any questions to ask, just store them up and then we can go over that. So it's number 6.
How can you still make me feel like crying? You disappeared ages ago. I was just a little boy. But still I feel like crying whenever I see this old photograph. Why can't I just leave you in the past and move on?
Suburbia, USA. Everything seems so normal, so middle America. And as we drive through the quiet streets, seeing a few cars on the road, maybe a few police officers eating donuts, there's a palpable nervousness, anxiety. We're actually going to be walking into a situation that the only certain thing is the uncertainty of it.
Mrs. Keene. Yeah, it's Evan. We're here. Okay, all right, okay. All right, nice and quiet.
Two men here that need to speak to you about something, and it's going to be okay.
I'm so sorry.
Hey, Simon.
Who the fuck are you guys?
I'm Evan, and this is Hodges, and we're transport counselors. We're going to be taking you to a new school today, okay?
Dad, what the fuck? Simon. Dad, you promised me.
Simon, Mr. Okay. Keene, I need you to leave the room now, please, okay? Simon, thank you.
Fuck up. I'm not going.
Okay,
I'm not
we're cool.
Anywhere.
Everything's cool. Relax, everything is cool. Relax. You got two choices, brother. You got the easy way or the hard way. Take it easy. Come on, Simon. You didn't even give me a chance to talk to you, man.
I don't want to fucking talk. Let go of me.
Come on, Simon. We're almost there.
You guys don't let him take me away, please. I fucking hate you guys.
McKean's, please go to the bedroom. Please go to the bedroom, McKean's.
Please, you guys, please.
Oh, shit, man. Hey.
God damn it.
Get in that car.
I'm not sure what, you know, why I was, why this was happening. You know, I was mandated to tons of therapy as a youth, anger counseling, and, you know, ended up doing a lot of therapy. But, you know, a lot of people pointed to the fact that I didn't grow up with a father figure, you know, as a point of, you know, possible pain and a reason why I acted out.
I've always tried to flee into the merciful land of fantasy. Maybe that's why I became a filmmaker. For years, I wrapped myself in the beautiful fantasy that I was the son of John F. Kennedy, the president's illegitimate but deeply loved European son. When my daddy was shot in Dallas, Texas in 1962, I took refuge in a Danish village church and stayed there until I was thrown out by the priest, who thought I was a teenager hiding in God's house.
This feels called Just the Right Amount of Violence. You can see it quite easily. It's available on the website. But to go back to your question then about how much time do we have for questions? 5 minutes, okay, we have to be a bit quick, but 5 minutes sum up your childhood traumas. He's asking about whether you went through a psychoanalytic process or whether the making of a film was one, is that right?
Yes.
Something like that.
I don't use money, or so I would never hire somebody to psychoanalyze me. It's much easier to do it when you do your own film, right? And of course, this obviously is a good thing that you show this, because this first little very sentimental voiceover meets telling that you know, this photo still makes me, weak at heart, right? I always, you know, as I said earlier on, I always take a personal thing and I use that to my own shadow is always heavily on the subject matter in front of the camera. Now you close the shot just before they go in and we will experience the ultimate betrayal, you know, this thing about a kid lying in his bed and suddenly those two, and his father has just signed him away, you know, they go in there, drag him out in the middle of the night, throw them in a car, take him from his wonderful Santa Monica, you know, upper middle class paradise kind of state, into the red desert of Utah, you know, and drop him in a teenage prison in there for, you know, the total betrayal, right? And then in a certain way, I experienced that much less dramatic, you know, when I kind of my father walked out of us at a certain point. You know, it's very banal, but it's of course everything, all stories stems from banal, you know, but it's something, yes, we all share, you know, this kind of betrayal, right? And therefore, you know, it's in this movie also you recognize the white dog in the beginning, right? You know, I always take elements from my life and put into the story matter. For example, very often I have a photograph of my beloved grandmother which are in so many of my films. I just put it on the wall or something like that. So they're little remnants of my own story, you know, in order for me to feel at home in all those places in the world where I work. Right? And therefore, you know, because it's, you know, I'm not dealing with truth, I'm dealing with emotions. And all those films are kind of it's a mutual narrative which are created by me behind the camera and by those people in front of the camera. The mutual pooling together of our life experiences, you know. That could be very young kids like those in California, or it could be that Jewish woman, old Jewish woman in Cape Town. It could be the Irish bachelor, right? It's a kind of mutual, you know, we're all united in that we're trying to find some kind of choreography going from being born to die, and finding some kind of meaning with that choreography before we fall into the big blackness of, which is maybe a reincarnation for something, I don't know. But so it's actually, you know, it's I'm in a constant state of analysis, you know, in doing those films.
Are there any other questions? Because I'm conscious of time. Don't be scared. No, yeah.
You said earlier that you try to.
Can you just wait for the microphone? Sorry, just a
You said earlier that you try to make your own reality out of your character's stories. How much room do you leave in the making of that reality for their own vision of what their reality looks like, if that makes any sense?
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. But of course, I make all this room I can. In a way, you know, when I say that I create my own reality, of course, it's not mean that I erase their reality. I just tell who tries to serve their reality to other people, you know, because the hand that's, you know, or the mouth that conveys other people's story always influences the story, right? And I think that's something that's enormously important to be conscious about, because this whole stupid concept which is in our media about that you can actually convey a story without influencing the story is bullshit, right? It's very dangerous bullshit. Both on an emotional level, but also on a political level.
Thank you.
Any more questions? The mic has to go back one row. One to the right.
Just following up on that, have you had experiences where people have said to you, actually, I wouldn't say that, this scene doesn't seem true to me, and you discuss it? Or...
Yeah, of course I've had, you know, if I haven't done my research properly, you know, but then it shows very, you know, I do fiction as well, and the problem with real actors is that sometimes they have this very good technique, so they can act out even bad lines, right? And it doesn't dawn on you before in the editing, when you do the editing, suddenly that this is bullshit, right? But with the good thing about working with these guys, they have no technique, right? So if the line is not right, it will fall out of their mouths like a stone, you know, and you will see it. And of course, you change the line, right? Or you get rid of it, right? Because they're much more honest to work with in that aspect, right? Because they don't have a technique. A technique is a good thing, but it's also a dangerous thing because you can actually hide emptiness with a technique, right?
Maybe the last question, and then we'll be in the bar afterwards. We can.
Do you consider your films to be mockumentaries, playing with the tropes of the documentary genre?
Not at all. I think this mockumentary. I haven't seen you. This mockumentary. I think it's kind of also a funny kind of strange stuff. I think my profound or paramount view is that all kind of if you always tell stories, whether you use documentary fragments or you use fictional. It's like a painter, you know. Either, you know, maybe you could say that a fiction filmmaker is the one who uses to press the paint out of the tubes, right? And the documentary painter is the one that finds elements of a bird feather or some sand and stuff like that and put on in between that on that canvas, right? But it's a totally subjective narrative process, right? And the only thing that matters is the intensity and the truthfulness, the honesty of the guy or the woman telling the story, right? That's what inspires, that what can actually maybe fuel the spectator's own kind of fortune hunt through life in order to try to find a reason, you know, whatever, right? So I heard about this thing. I never saw any of those films, and I really dislike the very concept.
It's a horrible word as well.
That's great.
We should probably wrap up there. Just before we do, Jon has arrived with a suitcase full of DVDs. It's one box set of the South African film, so it's a trilogy plus one, which he's going to sell at an extremely cheap price of, what is it, what did we agree, 30 quid? 50 in Denmark, so he's not £20 off student discount. So we'll be outside somewhere. If you want to watch some more of the films, you can purchase a box set. But Jon, it's been brilliant, and tomorrow Deja Vu's on again on Saturday, so if you've got time to watch Deja Vu, you'll get more of an insight. If you don't already know, it's a film comprised of sequences, sections of all his work going back.
Yeah, it's 40 years
or something.
It's again to keep within that world, that symbolic of the painter. It's like a painter, an old guy like myself, an old painter, you know, when suddenly one day he takes all his paintings, put out on the wall of his studio, he goes up a big ladder on his weak legs, you know, get a little dizzy up there, looks down, see all his paintings, and suddenly it dawns on him that those paintings come together as a jigsaw puzzle, telling a bigger story, right? Which, of course, to a certain degree, is his own narrative about trying to find a road from cradle to grave. Is that how you say it?
Yeah, okay. Cradle to grave.
Cradle.
Yeah. Cradle to grave.
Cradle to grave. Okay. Let those be the last word.
Right? Yeah.
Thank you for coming.